I'm glad they made her broken, you know what I mean? Because it's like, you release a legend, make sure that they're fucking broken, alright? Like, their kick can be super bad, but make them broken as a character, and then nerf it afterwards. Apex, like, I don't want to wait a full season for a character to come out, and then when that character comes out, it is completely ass and no one plays it.
Back in the olden days, when the computer from CS Office was considered premium gaming hardware, games would kind of just release and that was it. None of the DLC or microtransactions or updates of today, the game just releases however it is and stays that way. So most developers had no reason to consider much past making as many people buy the game as possible. But as the games industry progressed and publishers realized they could milk more money from the consumer after they'd already bought the game itself, DLC such as map packs for COD or Halo or whatever became relatively common. They still existed before this, but a large portion of studios didn't really care much until about 2005-ish. At this point, the tactics of modern times still hadn't been fully developed yet, so generally the focus was more on just making the DLC interesting enough to make the player bother buying it in the first place. I suspect this was roughly around the time when developers noticed that when the weapons or DLC items were more powerful than what had previously existed, they would sell better. Even this long ago, there were metas within games, but most of the time this wasn't intentionally done in any way and just happened, either as a result of lazy developers or bad playtesting, and since updating a game after you bought it still hadn't been popularized, the meta would rarely change. However, in recent years, the live service model has been popularized. This is where the publisher puts a mostly done version of the game up onto a platform such as Steam, and releases updates and new stuff for the game regularly, which should be a great thing, since any issues or vulnerabilities within the game can be fixed. But studios quickly realized they could make a game relatively cheap or free, so that the potential player base was increased while adding in-game purchases as their main method of making money. And this started the trend of making new guns or characters overpowered, since players were more likely to buy something if it was strong. But players complained a lot about this, so over time more sneaky methods were introduced, such as... If you couldn't already tell from the playlist in the intro, Warzone has a pretty bad history with their balancing decisions, especially in the first Warzone game, which was released in 2019-ish. As a live service game, Warzone can't exactly sell DLC to make money off of their poor balancing decisions, but regardless of that, Activision has found a plethora of ways to exploit the player. In terms of actual guns, there are too many examples, so here's a quick fire round. MAC-10, Grau, ASVAL, DMR, FFAR, FAR 83, and way too many others. I'll put the playlist from the intro in the description if you are for some reason interested in looking through these statistics, but for the ADHD people, here's the plot synopsis. A lot of guns were released as stronger versions of guns that already existed. Personally, I'm far more interested in how Warzone makes money off of having its weapons be strong on release. The general strategy revolves around the Battle Pass and skins, with two new weapons a season and each new weapon being obtainable through the Battle Pass for free, one at about level 20 and one at maybe level 40. This has likely been changed for the new Warzone, but I'm too lazy to install that piece of trash just to try and figure out how the system works. The reason why I think it was done in this manner is so that any new weapon is accessed faster by someone who is willing to pay. The blueprint system, which allows for a player to equip a weapon they don't own by having a blueprint of it, among other things that don't really matter for this, gave Activision the ability to give a person who was willing to pay for the premium battle pass a weapon right at the start of the pass without the downside of needing to explicitly say that they got access to the weapon faster. The premium pass also made progression to the full unlock faster, but not by enough that I actually care. In accordance with this, if the new weapon that was just released was, say, absurdly overpowered to the point of being oppressive, then a lot more people would be willing to pay money so that they could get fast access to said overpowered weapon, because if they didn't, they would be getting stomped by other people who did pay for it, and losing usually isn't very fun, at least in my experience. Interestingly enough, Warzone also has a second way of making people pay to win in some manner. When a new game is released, such as Black Ops Cold War, its weapons are introduced into the Warzone alongside the weapons that are already there from the previous games. When this happens, often people will buy the game that the weapons are from, and one of the reasons why they would do this is so that they can level up the weapons in the multiplayer, since that is significantly faster than trying to level them up in Warzone. The reason why leveling up weapons is important at all is that these levels grant a player different attachments, which often significantly increase the effectiveness of the gun, and therefore being able to level up the guns faster in a less punishing environment is helpful. Taylor Swift out of a murders.
IS THERE GUNS IN THIS GAME?! OH LOOK, IT'S THE GUY WHO'S BEEN CHASING ME THE WHOLE LOBBY! GIVE ME A GUN!
Admittedly, that Timmy clip in the intro wasn't exactly word for word. His points were more across the line that he thinks Vantage was boring on release and would have been more interesting if she was instead unreasonably strong. Alongside how he believes that when the new character or weapon is at least somewhat overpowered, the game feels better to play since it feels like more has changed with the new release. As of time of writing, Apex has been pretty okay with making characters have reasonable power recently and be interesting without messing with the meta too much, but historically it was very common. When Sia was introduced in Season 10, he was unreasonably strong, mainly because Bloodhound was already considered a meta character at the time and he was just a significantly more powerful version of Bloodhound since his passive allowed him to scan enemy gamers without the standard requirement of using one of your abilities that has a cooldown. In addition, his ultimate was basically a free scan for an entire minute in a 75 meter radius around wherever you placed it, and his tactical could scan enemies, reveal their health, stun them with a big fucking flashbang effect all over their screen, and cancel literally any action the players were currently doing. Reviving? How about no! Using an ability? Not even a chance. Fucking healing? How dare you even attempt such He was quickly nerfed to remove the flashbang effect and slightly decrease the effectiveness of the rest of his abilities, but after his Watson dominated with him in pro play back in the Year 2 Championship, people realized that the nerfs weren't nearly enough to remove Sia from being dominant, and he remained a staple pick in pro play up until about Season 17, where the players were finally released from their purgatory after a massive amount of nerfs. Significantly less long-lasting was someone like Conduit, when she released the ability to regroup with the team at extreme speed, fully heal a teammate's shield within a second or two, and completely block off entire areas of the map made Conduit a great generalist character, who could do pretty much anything and could be played in multiple roles. So she was highly picked in both ranked play and pro play for about 2 seasons. At which point her synergy with Revenant was nerfed and her base abilities were weak enough that other characters were usually the better pick. An honourable mention goes to both Valkyrie, who launched in Season 9, where her great repositioning and rotation carried her to be meta, until about the same time Sia came out of the meta, and Catalyst, who had such great area control on release, alongside having friendly Sia tacticals go through her big wall of an ultimate, that she was a common choice in both the Year 3 Split 2 playoffs and Year 3 Championships of the Apex Legends Global Series. This also applies to weapons such as the Kara and Nemesis, both of which seem to have been pretty insane on release, at least if you're to believe the pick rates in AOGS, that is. Apex follows a pretty similar method of money-making to Warzone, but with some important distinctions. Most notably of which being that the lack of unlockable gameplay content in battle passes and weapons not needing to be unlocked places a far greater emphasis on skins as the main way to make money. On top of this, Warzone has its custom loadouts which require leveling up and unlocking a gun, while Apex has no such system. While it is slightly harder to track than the act of purchasing the premium pass in Warzone, I think it's safe to assume that people are going to be a lot more willing to buy a skin for a new character if this character also happens to be strong enough that they'll actually get to see the skin, since they'll feel their time is a lot less wasted when playing a character that's at least decent. Apex does actually have one more scheme that could be considered under this category, although I leave that up to debate. This being the interesting habit of buffing a character right before their heirloom is released. While I obviously don't have the necessary internal data required to prove that this causes more people to buy heirlooms, I think there's a damn good chance considering how often Respawn does this right before the heirloom is released. Overall, I say green album. Well then, that just about covers all the big multiplayer FPS that I think we're talking about. No, I'm not doing it. No, you can't make me. Risk of Rain does things a bit differently, owing mainly to how it is structured, more like how games used to be, where you buy the game and there is paid packs of DLC content, instead of adding each bit of paid content as its own separate purchase. Also, this is helped by the game being PvE co-op instead of PvP, so people care a lot less about what is strong. When the Survivors of the Void DLC was introduced, it added both new normal items and a new type of item known as Void items. The normal items included stuff like Ignition Tank, which increases all fire damage by 300%, which is grossly overpowered considering that gasoline is already a relatively good item, and Pocket ICBM, which effectively triples the effectiveness of all rocket-based items. The Void items were corrupted versions of existing items, so if you pick one up, all of your stacks of the original item are also converted. With items like Weeping Fungus being outright better than its standard variant on all characters except Engineer, and Plasma Shrimp being just as good if not better than ATG Launcher, Void items were oftentimes at least situationally better than their counterparts. While I would usually say that this was encouraging players to buy the DLC so that they get more powerful, Hopu Games added a little extra mechanic which mitigates this exact issue, alongside being nice to the player. When you're in co-op play and even a single person has bought the DLC, all people in the game get to use the full scope of DLC items and content, which is such a good idea that I'm surprised I don't see it very often. The Mind Electric.
I think someone has daddy issues.
I do not have daddy issues! I am a special fucking boy!
Megadeth isn't much of a conventional live service game, although to be fair, it isn't much of a conventional anything at this point. Despite this, Hyperkill and its designer Hackerman do a surprisingly good job of making pretty much any weapon or mod feel interesting regardless of their relative strength. It's important to note that Uber Murder uses the Doom method of introducing weapons. If you know what that means, great. If you don't, go play Ultra Kill or Doom Eternal or just look at this graph. Something like the green nail gun usually wouldn't be considered too useful in most gameplay, but if you attach a magnet to something like a Morris and use up one of the charges, instant kill. While this is a bit slower than the standard method, which involves shotgun swapping and the red arm, it lets you keep the ability to parry, which is pretty darn convenient. Or maybe something like the rocket launcher, which is relatively weak on its own, but if you inevitably fall off of the stage in Cybergrind, you can shoot a rocket straight down, grapple it, and get right back up. There is also a more efficient way to accomplish the same effect, but it requires highly specific timing and angles, so I can't be bothered. Also, it has some speedrun tech, but explaining that would require a college essay, so I'll just give you the thesis statement. Even the coin, which is pretty innocuous at first, you shoot it and your shot ricochets onto an enemy's weak point. Well, now you can split your shot, and now you can ricochet your railgun into the coin. And now there's an entire 20-minute video purely for the purpose of showcasing and explaining all the different ways to use the coin. It's actually very interesting. I'd recommend watching it if you're in the game and are even somewhat invested into it. I'll give it Dream Suite in C major. I don't think this needs much of an explanation. The observant among you may have noticed a slight trend within the examples I used here. If you did, great. If you didn't, here's a very bad graph. Now, I would usually add a scale, but Overwatch 2 already broke mine, so this is the best I can do right now. Now, obviously, this correlation isn't the only reason for the imbalance, but I would consider it to be of note at the very least. Oftentimes, these publishers and companies care a lot less about the individual player experience and would much rather please their shareholders in place of them. This causes a lot of large studios to have less dev input into what is added or changed and a far larger amount of microtransactions, especially the more predatory kind brought upon by making unbalanced new releases, since those will usually make the most money. I find this to be an issue even in the more quote-unquote competitive games, such as, you know, yeah. Although all of these are also made by large studios as well, so that can't really be discounted. Another notable game would be CSGO or CS2, but there hasn't been a weapon released there for something like 10 years, so I don't care enough to actually talk about it in any depth. Something something, RA Revolver something something.